So thank you very much for doing this. You're in Massachusetts. What is your background, doctor?
So I'm a physicist.
Yeah.
So the main thing is that I actually work in a field called complexity science. So I use mathematics that is by the standard statement, it's kind of beyond statistics. Because statistics, in thinking about how things are independent of each other, doesn't describe the real world. But I've been working on pandemics for over 15 years. Mm. I studied pandemics, and the basic thing that the math that I do does is it's like helping you figure out how to control something. Like, let's say you have a car. Yes. And the car is sitting outside, and you either you somehow have amnesia and you don't know how to drive a car. So you walk out to the car, and what are you going to do? You might open the door, close the door a few times. You might open the trunk. But if you knew that by turning the steering wheel and pressing the gas and brakes and be the gear shift, right, the transmission, then you would be able to figure out how to drive a car. But if you didn't know that, you might end up sitting in the back seat or whatever, and you won't know how to deal with it very well. So the trick in the math that I do is that it points straight at what the variables are that you have to control a system. And in the context of a pandemic, there are three major things that one has to know. One is, R, which everyone talks about, the transmission rate. And the other is the fact that if you are able to control travel, then you can control the disease locally. And that's super important because, people constantly say, it's really, how are you going to get rid of this disease? It's everywhere. But the answer is, if we only try to get rid of it locally, then it's much, much easier to control it. In fact, that makes it possible to control it. And then the last thing is that, and this is also one of these things that you have to think about why it's hard to understand. But basically, it's a statement that the disease is like a fire. And you know that when you have a fire, you have to make sure and put it all out. Once you put it all out, you're in a completely different situation, right? Because if you leave a small fire growing, then it'll always regrow. But if you put it all the way out, then you can ignore it. And so one of the biggest challenges of the pandemic from the beginning, and I was involved in other pandemics before this, is one of the biggest challenges is for people to really understand that we can stop it. Because if you think you have to always live with it, which is how people talk about it a lot, then it kind of shapes your thinking, right? You say, well, we have to trade off business and health. There's this trade-off between health and freedom. But if you can get rid of it, just like with a fire, you wouldn't live with it. You would get rid of it, and then you would go back to doing everything that we want, including business, including freedom, including everything else. And if you look at people who really know about pandemics, i.e. not, people who have studied it in school, and not almost everyone in the Western world has not been involved in pandemic response directly because we've kind of eliminated diseases, right? We've eliminated malaria. We've eliminated a lot of diseases from the West. And so we don't deal with elimination very much in the West. But in Africa and in Asia, they've dealt with elimination. And so when the pandemic happened originally, they thought about it in a different way. Now, if we go to today, and I want to talk about the pandemic today a little bit, with the Delta variant. The Delta variant is kind of the pandemic all over again. Every time we have a new variant, it's a different story, right? I mean, think about it. We can have one virus all over the world, and then now we have a new virus somewhere. And it starts spreading as if the other virus was not even there. And so every time you have a new variant, it's like having a whole new pandemic. And the thing about the Delta variant is that it's much more severe in terms of its qualities overall. First of all, it is more severe as a disease. And in particular, it affects young people more. And the other thing is that it is more, much more transmissible. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of over twice as transmissible as the original variant. And so it's really better to think about it as a new pandemic than it is to think about it as the same pandemic. And part of what that means is that everything that we know about controlling the old virus doesn't necessarily hold in controlling the new one.
We have Delta, we have Lambda. Are they very similar?
Actually, Delta and Lambda are very different genetically.
Okay.
So one of the things that happened is that Alpha and the South African variant, Alpha was the British, you know, the UK origin variant. There was a South African origin variant. And then there was original variant that came from Brazil. They were all kind of somewhat similar in their genetics. But the Lambda is actually even more different. It kind of has a bunch of different mutations. And Lambda is new enough and hasn't been studied enough. The places where it's grown rapidly are not places where it's been studied extensively. So we don't even know very much its qualities yet. So each of these is almost a different one. One of the things that happens if you have a different virus, right, is that immunity from one doesn't translate to immunity from the other. Mm-hmm. So there's some crossover immunity, but Delta compared to the original variants and the Alpha variant has really undermined immunity. Now, some of that immunity is from previous infections, and some of that immunity is from the vaccines, because the vaccines were to target the original variant. And so the problem that we have is that the Delta is undermining the immunity from the vaccines, which is the tool that, you know, this tool that was supposed to solve all of our problems. And, you know, if, you know, the reason why it was so powerful is that it reduced the risk of infection by about a factor of 10 or 20. So people are trying to pretend, you know, hey, it's a total solution. Like, you know, everybody wants a magic bullet with a pill that you go to the doctor gives you this pill, you go home, you're done. Vaccines don't work that way. And even against the original variant, the vaccine is a reduction by a factor of 10 or 20. So it's like if you knew you were going to go out and get sick and you end up in the hospital for weeks, you wouldn't do it. It's just not worth that lunch that you were going to have in that restaurant. But let's say it was a chance of 1 in 10 or 1 in 20 that you would get sick in a hospital for multiple weeks. Would you then go out to the restaurant and have that lunch? Probably not, I'm guessing. Right. So one of the things that happens is that the vaccine reduces it by a factor of 10 or 20, but it doesn't make the risk go away. But with the Delta variant, the current reports are that it's basically like flipping a coin. So it's like 50% chance that if you go to the restaurant, you're going to end up sick in the hospital for a few weeks. So the reduction in the what's called the efficacy of the vaccine, the ability of the vaccine to prevent you from getting sick, is not that much with the Delta variant. Hmm. And that's bad news, of course, because if, you know, we surely don't want to get sick from a disease that, you know, I mean, again, you know, people know different things about this disease, but it causes a lot of problems that a lot of people don't know. Like it causes brain damage in a high percentage of people that get it, including people who don't get severe cases.
You actually tweeted somebody speaking about that recently, about the, here we go. This is a virus we know can enter the brain that causes long-term neurological deficits, that causes thinning in parts of the brain that are associated with taste, smell, and memory.
Yeah, so this is, I mean, if you read that and you realize that this was about you and not a character in a movie. So one of the real problems that we have today, just to digress for a moment, is that people are used to watching all kinds of horror movies, right? How many horror movies have you seen in your life, right? Yeah. So you've seen all these horror movies, but none of that ever mattered. Right. So if you read something that's really awful, you know, this is invasion of the body snatchers, right? You know, there's this disease that comes in and infects you, and then you infect your family and you infect your friends and all of this stuff, and it causes you brain damage. You wouldn't want it. But the problem is that we've seen all these movies. So we say, hey, this is just like a movie that we've seen, but this is the real world. Right. I was thinking about this because we all know these stories of people who go to national parks and they fall off cliffs. Yeah. And why did they fall off the cliff? Because somehow they've separated themselves from the real world. They've watched a lot of TV, they've watched a lot of movies, and it hasn't sunk in that this is real. That this is not something that you can just, you know, imagine is not there after you watch the movie, after you read the news. It's the real deal. So here we have this disease which invades people's brains and causes brain damage. And we know this. And we have studies that show that it reduces IQ. And this is including even people who not only have mild cases, but don't even have symptoms, right? So we know that there are long COVID symptoms where people can't breathe very well, they have a hard time doing any kind of activity, their heart's, you know, doing all kinds of crazy things, and they have, you know, you can look at it online, there's huge number of symptoms to this. But first of all, everyone's going, well, you know, maybe that's not gonna happen to me, but it's a large percentage of people who get this virus have those problems, but the symptoms, but the neurological effects happen even for people who don't have symptoms, noticeable symptoms, right? I mean, then you measure it and then you find them, right? You measure it in the structure of the brain. This is the thinning of the brain. And you measure it in the, you know, IQ tests. So, I mean, if people really stopped for a moment and said, instead of this is a movie, this is the real world, this is super scary. And so we have this situation where we have a disease that we surely don't want to get. And even more so, we don't want, you know, our wife, our husband, our children, our parents, or, you know, we don't want anybody to get this disease. But the fact that this is scary and a disease we don't want to get gets swamped by this standard advertising of, hey, let's go and buy a Coca-Cola and have fun. Right? So again, you know, going out and buying a Coca-Cola might be fun under some circumstances, but if the price is getting long COVID and having brain damage, it's surely not fun.
No.
At least not the one.
Why do you believe people are not taking this as serious as they should?
I think this is, if I were to point to one thing, it's this dissociation from the reality. It's the fact that people somehow feel that this is kind of a bad movie that doesn't seem to go away, that it's not their problem. It's got to be someone else's problem. You know, maybe someone in Africa, maybe someone in Asia, it's got their problem. We didn't experience this. We grow up with it. And one of the things that think people might do is think about a time when they really encountered something that was scary in their own lives. Right. You know, I don't know. Maybe someone, you know, got too close to a cliff and fell halfway down, or maybe they, you know, there are lots of things that happen to people. I was in a fire, you know, there was a conversation where a physician from Australia went through the fires that were in Australia. But this was not long before the pandemic. And she'd see them out of her window, right, in the forests around the house. And you know there's a fire, you smell it, you see it, you so on. And it probably helped them respond to the pandemic to experience this fire, because they knew that they had to get together, the community had to take responsibility for each other, to protect each other, and to make sure it wasn't going to burn down, you know, their neighborhood, which happened in fires in California, actually in fires in airplanes. And the fire is the right way to think about this disease. It's a time when, you know, you call on the fire department, but, you know, fire departments often can't do enough to put out fires. In the case of a pandemic, it's really about the community taking ownership. It's the power of the community to make a decision to stop this.
Is and, it also and, in the power of the individual?
That's the problem. An individual can protect themselves to some extent, right? You can stay home, you can wear a mask, and that doesn't protect you very well, because other people have to wear their masks too in order to protect you, right? The people who are sick have to wear masks, not just the person who's, you know, not yet infected.
Right.
But you can wear a mask, you can do, you know, drive-by pickup of groceries and delivery or whatever it is. You can avoid things, but eventually other people don't stop it. You're going to have to go someplace. You know, you're going to have to go to your doctor's office. You're going to go, something's going to happen, and your family's going to want you to show up, and other things. And eventually you're going to take just enough risk and you're going to end up sick. And so the problem is that an individual can only protect themselves so much. And so it's like, it's very comforting to go and get a vaccine shot. Yes. Because that you can do yourself. And of course, you can't really get a vaccine shot yourself. You have to have the companies that making the vaccine and the delivery process, and the person, the healthcare system has to be ready to give you the shot. So it's really a collective action to give you this vaccine shot. But one of the problems with this is the society is really set up for people who make money. And the business community, we know this, right? So the pharmaceutical company is going to make money at the end of the day, whether you pay it or the government pays it. So the whole system is going to cater to make this happen. But nobody's going to make money if you're not going to the restaurant and eating dinner there. So the point is the following. We have a huge challenge to shift from individual action to shared action to stop a pandemic. And I've worked in Africa and places where people, you know, have all kinds of problems, poverty and everything that you could imagine is tough. But if you have a village that can get together and stop the disease, it'll be gone. And right now in India, in Uttar Pradesh, where there are 225 million people in one state of India, it's the biggest subnational unit in the world. They have one case per 5 million people. One per 5 million. And they're doing hundreds of thousands of tests per day. So the reason is that they use a strategy which we call a green zone strategy. And the way they talk about it is they say, my village, you know, corona free. My village corona free, that means that everyone is geared to eliminating the disease in their village. It doesn't matter whether this village is fighting that village over there. Everyone's concerned about their own community. So what we really need in many parts of the world is for people to make a decision that they're going to get together with their neighbors and stop this disease. Because the community can protect itself much, much better than an individual can protect itself. But in order to do that, you have to work with your neighbors. And we know, right? I know one neighbor on one side of my house, the other neighbor I don't know, right? So the question is, how do we get together as a community? And there's a huge advantage if people can get together and say to their neighbors, look, do you really want to get brain damage? I don't think so. Let's work together and figure out how to get rid of this disease. And the government in general and governments across the world have all of these conflicts, and they tend to solve problems by compromise. You cannot compromise with a disease.
No,
it doesn't come to the table. It doesn't sign an agreement and say, okay, you know, I'll do it halfway. If you do this, you know, it's just, it doesn't work that way.
We've heard that people that get COVID, the symptoms after, like the taste, the smell, I've definitely heard of that one, but the brain, I didn't know that it actually is affecting people's brains.
Well, taste and smell are actually harmed because of the brain damage. The reason why you can't smell and taste is actually because the taste and smell centers in your brain have been attacked by the virus. And the other part of the brain that gets attacked is the hippocampus, which has a role in memory and in spatial orientation. And there are other parts of the brain that has to do with emotions. So that are being directly, as far as we know, according to the data, being directly affected by the virus. That doesn't mean that other parts of the brain are not. It's just that those are the most obvious places where the damage is happening.
Doctor, when you look at the differences in terms of response from the West versus New Zealand, Israel, why aren't we adopting some of these practices?
Well, you can even look closer to home. Right, eastern part of Canada, there are four provinces that are basically corona-free. They did it the same way that India did. They said, we're not going to live with this, and they fought the disease, and they got rid of it within a few weeks originally, and they've been responding like to fires. When there's a fire, we put it out. If Quebec had gotten rid of the disease, they would probably never have had a fire afterwards, or many fewer ones. But because Quebec didn't, then, you know, New Brunswick and Nova Scotia and so on, they ended up importing some cases and they had to fight them. But the point is that, sure, just like with a person in their neighborhood, a person can only protect themselves so much, but a neighborhood can protect you. The same thing is true about provinces and the country. The provinces can protect yourself so far, and then the country can do even better. But if you look at Nova Scotia and New Brunswick and the other Atlantic provinces, they're basically been, you know, without the disease. Yeah. And most of the time they've been experiencing normal lives, and their economies have done much better. If you look at the analysis of economic activity and the business stress on the business, sure, they've lost a little bit of, you know, tourism because they've shut, you know, limited border. But, you know, compared to the domestic part of their economy, that's, you know, they've done incredibly well economically. And I can give you a paper that's done analysis. There's an economic analysis by Cecile Philippe, which is published, and you can put a reference to it.
Sure, definitely will.
In your blog, in your whatever, in your
podcast, yeah.
Podcast. So the point is that it's really straightforward. And the straightforward thing is, the worst thing that you can do is let the fire burn. There's just no doubt about it, that by putting out the fire, you're going to do better. Nobody, you don't have to get a degree in physics or in medicine or in biology or in epidemiology or anything. Getting rid of the disease is super better than trying to navigate how much risk you're going to take in going to restaurants or whatever. And the business community in particular has been just totally misinformed. And the reason is very simple. Everyone in the business community thinks that the bad guy, or almost everyone, the bad guy is the government. So the government tells you to do something, you're going to say, what do you mean? I'm going to oppose you. And the problem is that what we really need is for the business community to go to the government and say, we need these restrictions because then we can get rid of the disease. And by getting rid of the disease, we're going to be able to go back to the pre-pandemic situation. Otherwise, we're going to get wave after wave after wave of these variants, and we're going to fight them with the vaccines that are not going to be effective enough. And we're going to try to pretend that it's not there when it's causing us brain damage. And we're going to have the disease once, and it's going to be prior condition for what happens the next time, right? Our lungs are damaged, hearts are damaged, mm-hmm. and then you get infected again. And people think that somehow it's going to be milder, but the more likely thing is it's going to kill you if it can get it again.
You know, when you look at the businesses, they're saying, if we put restrictions on us, we're going to be closed. But they don't realize that the long-term effect here is, no, we can stay open if we have the restrictions. And businesses are slowly realizing that people are now not even showing up at their businesses because they're afraid. If there's no tracing or testing, we don't know. I don't want to go out there. People are nervous.
The thing that we need to do is to get all of society together, which means businesses have to stand up and share the effort with everyone, right? The people who are the vulnerable people, who, you know, government may claim that they need, you know, the economy to be open because they need to go to work and get, you know, get paid. People have to survive during the strong action that you need first. Right. You need a few weeks. Right. The usual statement is you need about 6 weeks to stop any, you know, the virus in its tracks.
I don't think, say, for example, a business wants to come out there and say, OK, we're going to ask for proof of vaccine or negative testing. Nobody wants to be the first one to do it because they're afraid that they're going to get the one star reviews. I think businesses are scared because there's no mandates.
The business community has, just like you have to get together with your neighbors in order to take action, the business community has to get together. People have to start saying, look, this is not a competitive thing. It's not me against you. It's us together. And the business community should do it by realizing that it is, if we stay in this state, it's going to be years before we get out of it. And we've already seen what it looks like. I mean, why have we been doing this for a year and a half when at any point in time, 6 weeks, we could have been out of it?
Do you believe this will last another couple of years? Delta, when you're looking at the trends?
Yeah, the usual statement is the amount of time it's going to last into the future is about as much time as it's lasted until now. But this correct statement is it'll last until we decide to get rid of it. The virus is not going to just decide to give up. We can decide to give up. That's what we're doing now. But the virus doesn't have a brain and doesn't, you can't say to it, look, let me convince you that you don't really want to do what you're doing. We'll have you do something else. And there are a lot of biologists, some biologists who keep thinking that the virus is going to get weaker and less severe. And I mean, I've been doing pathogen biology also in the past, right, in terms of the pandemic behavior and all kinds of things. And they're in the wrong regime. There are certain circumstances where viruses become less strong. But this is not the circumstance. And we see that, right? If it was going to get weaker and less severe, it would have happened already. Instead, every few months, we get another virus, which is worse, is more severe. Why would anybody think that that's going to change, right? Nowadays, we have lots of experience. I would have told you the same thing 18 months ago at the beginning because I have the math that shows it. But by now, I don't even have to use my math. It's just you see it. You have to be kind of blind in order not to see that the disease is getting worse rather than better. Mm-hmm.
We have a critical problem here in Canada where people don't want to take a vaccine and specifically choose not to take, well, now we don't have AstraZeneca, but choose not to take Moderna because they want Pfizer. So all these vaccines are getting expired and useless. Well, why is this happening? There's like a separation of Moderna versus Pfizer. And when you look at them, we don't ask in details about Advil and Tylenol. Why are we doing this so much with Pfizer and Moderna?
So there may be reasons that people want to do that, but I think my statement would be more fundamental. The narrative in many, many parts of the world is about conflict among people. It's got to be someone's fault. And if you notice, that's true in the United States, it's true in the UK, it's true in Germany, it's true. Everyone has someone to blame. It's the other political party that's at fault for the problems that were happening, right? And the truth is that this is one more narrative that's just flawed. And the reason why it's flawed is because the important thing is just that we collaborate together. And so rather than focusing on why other people are not doing what we think would be reasonable for them to do, what we just have to do is focus on the fact that we all want to get rid of this disease. We all don't want our neighbors, our family, our friends to get infected and have, you know, brain damage and spend the rest of our lives, you know, doing less in life than what we would really like to do. And instead, and again, I mean, this is going to get worse and worse because people are getting reinfected and reinfected. And if we let this go around and around with the new variants, this is what's going to control our lifespans. It's already shortened lifespans. So what we need to do is we need to think in terms of how do we get together as a community, as a province, as a country, and ultimately as a world and say, you know, enough of this nonsense. It's time to get rid of this disease. And that's the decision that matters. And then whether people are arguing about Pfizer or Moderna or AstraZeneca or whatever else is going to go away because we'll solve that problem. It's not the most important problem. The most important problem is actually the decision that we want to eliminate this. And again, Canada has proven in a way that's not super obvious that there is a choice to do elimination. And we don't have to look at Australia and New Zealand and China and other places that have been able to do that. Canada is, if anything, the best place in the West, right, in the Americas and across Europe and so on, because you have a real world example. And if you can't learn from Canada, why, you know, do you expect anyone to learn from Australia and New Zealand? Australia and New Zealand have refined the reaction response. Basically, what it means is that normally you need an entire incubation period to stop a fire, stop an outbreak. So you need about 14 days. And Australia and New Zealand have shown that with a few days of lockdown, sometimes two, sometimes three, you can completely stop an outbreak if you catch it right at the beginning. Because if you catch it right at the beginning, you can freeze everything in place and go look for everybody that has the disease. And if you do that well, then you can open up in a couple of days. Even though normally the situation is that one person might infect people and they don't show symptoms for another bunch of days. But what you really need to do is to find all of the people that might be infected, stick them into quarantine, and the rest of the world can keep going. So you can do it with a lockdown of only a few days, and then you're out of it. And that's incredible. So instead of having 2 weeks or more, you have one or two or three days. With the Delta variant, it's worse. And that's why now in New South Wales, they're kind of struggling to control the outbreak. But they didn't react fast enough. But the Delta is harder. But again, the longer we wait to do this, the harder it's going to get, because the Delta is going to be replaced by the Lambda, and the Lambda by the Theta, and the Theta by the Zeta, or whatever it is. And we just don't want to make it worse for ourselves. It's like, right now we're losing the battles, with the exception of a few places in the world. But we haven't lost the war yet. But if we choose not to fight, why would we expect to be able to win the war?
What do you think about Alberta recently, with everything that's been going on?
So the two things, number one, I've heard that Alberta, they're opening up like the UK did. They want to eliminate restrictions. 1,200 scientists from around the world signed a document published in The Lancet saying that that was totally immoral and unacceptable as a way of dealing with a pandemic. It's allowing people to get sick. Children are going to get sick. Children are going to get these symptoms of long COVID. Children are going to have these brain damage. We don't know the extent of it, surely, but everything tells us we should expect there to be substantial damage to people who have no control of their destiny, in particular our children. Why would we do it? It doesn't make any sense.
School is opening September 7th. School is opening, and this is scary. No tracing, right. No testing.
Super scary. On the other hand, I've heard that in Alberta, people are protesting. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that everybody should know, in every place that there's been done a poll that I've seen, includes in America, includes in South America, in the US, South America, Europe, the vast majority of people want to take stronger action to stop this disease. But there's an interesting thing. It was shown in a poll in Argentina, but I know it from talking with many people. People who want to take stronger action think that they're the 20%, and the 20% think they're the 80%. It's the opposite of the reality. And what we've seen is that in Alberta, I've seen that there are protests, that people are saying, we do not want the government policy to take place, the relaxing of the restrictions or whatever, the relaxing of the contact tracing, the relaxing of the surveillance, yeah, and so on, the testing.
Yeah. So if you're positive, you don't need to isolate, is what they're saying. And I don't understand the logic or the rationale, and I'm really trying to figure it out. Why would an elected official or chief medical officer say something like that? Because as a leader, you know, for this past year and a half, we've been listening to you, and all of a sudden now you've just dropped the ball. I think it's not only a slap on the face for a lot of people, but you're lost. You're confused. Yeah.
So there's no doubt that they're confused, but the way I think mm-hmm. about it, at least now, is that people want the pandemic to be gone.
Right.
So, you know, politicians think that they can kind of pretend the pandemic is gone. Hmm. And if they pretend the pandemic is gone, people will like them, because everyone will say, hey, okay, our government made the pandemic gone, so we'll like them and we'll vote them back into office. But what's happened again and again, right? If you remember Italy, way back at the beginning of the pandemic, they thought that they could ignore the pandemic. And of course they had horrendous deaths and, you know, tremendous suffering, really awful. And that propagated through Europe and then to the United States and so on. The point is that, and in the United States now, we see the same thing happening, right? The Delta is growing in the US. And now all of a sudden, after it's grown to 50,000 cases per day in the US, which is, I mean, the US has been much worse in its response than Canada. All of a sudden, the CDC says, oh, yes, masks. I guess we need masks after all. What a surprise. We couldn't have known that before, but I guess now it's clear that we need masks, even for vaccinated people. Now, I can tell you that we've been shouting that we need masks in the US. And in fact, we've been shouting that we need to take stronger action instead of letting this disease get out of control again. But the problem is that the government really wants to pretend. Remember this business about people looking at movies?
Yes.
They just want to pretend that this is a movie that we've been watching, that, you know, hey, we shut the TV off, we leave the movie theater, and now we can be okay. And what we need to make sure is that everybody, as far as we can let them know, understands this is not a movie. This is the real world. And if you walk off that cliff in the movie and fall, you don't just get back up and walk away. And you don't have the ability to to change the reality after you get sick.
What are your thoughts on vaccine passports and digital health passes?
It's a little bit of a tricky question. So once we have vaccines that are effective, if they stop transmission by a factor of 10 or 20, then we can stop transmission enough in those people so that the cases would go down among the vaccinated people. There are several problems with it. One, the most important problem today is that the Delta isn't that way, right? It's only by coin flip. So vaccine passports are out of the loop for really helping once you have a vaccine that's not that effective. There are other problems with it that we could talk about.
Obviously, yeah. But
the main thing, again, is not that. No. Ultimately, the question is the following. If we wanted to get rid of this disease, what would be the best way to do it? To take 12 months to do it, 6 months to do it, 3 months to do it, or 6 weeks to do it? Which would you prefer?
6 weeks. Get it done.
That's it. So if you want to do it in 6 weeks, you do everything possible to stop transmission and you stop asking these questions about, can I get away with this? Or can I get away with that? Or can we do open this? Or can we open that? Because that's not going to help. It's actually just going to make it worse.
Mm-hmm. Doctor, how do we find people to believe this? Because I think there's this clear opposition where they say, you know, this is a flu symptom. Our government even opened up, so we don't need a vaccine. It's not even effective. What you guys are putting things in your own body. Like, this has given every opposition the opportunity to mock and laugh and say, well, the government's even saying, "Ha, we're open for business." And everyone else that got vaccinated, we didn't need to. Thank God we didn't. How do we convince our neighbors?
The first thing is to talk to the people that are going to understand. Right, we have to start with the people who are aware that this is a problem. Make sure that they understand that we have a solution. Mm-hmm. That there is a solution, that we have to do it together. Yeah. And we have to, super important. If we protect ourselves, right, most important understand is that there's going to be a period of time where we have this disease. If you get infected during that time, the world is going to be very different for you than if you don't get infected during that time. So we have to start by taking precautions for ourselves and for the people that we love. And it's not always easy. Not all of my, I don't have a magic that enables me to convince my sister or whoever to take the same precautions that I would like her to take. Okay, that's the way it is. But we have to engage in that challenge. And so if we focus, first of all, on self and on family and on friends, and then we reach out to others in a community of shared concern and values and the realization that we want to solve this problem for all of us, then we can go to the next level. And the next level is going to be convincing the people that are farther away. But it's much less helpful to try to convince the people that are farther away than to first connect with the people that we can talk with, that will share the effort of going to the next level. And there are definitely people in Alberta. There's a Zero COVID Alberta group that are working very hard. And we have a community around the world. We've just established a World Health Network that connects all of these teams that have been working hard to explain this. And the bottom line is, it's ultimately not that hard to understand. It's like a fire. Mm-hmm. And if we think about it like a fire, and if we make sure that we understand you know, how bad the Delta is and the vaccines are not going to solve the problem. It's not that hard. I mean, we've been talking about it for about 40 minutes or so, something like 45 minutes. And we've basically said the same thing already half a dozen times, right? The point is that it's not that hard to understand. But when people are confused, when people are, you know, have been told all kinds of different things, it takes a little while for all of these pieces to straighten out. And now there is need for us to, you know, carefully and in an understanding way to reach out.
Yeah.
And the business community is really good at understanding how to do messaging, how to share information, and how to be clear about the consequences of what will happen if we don't do the things that we need to do to get rid of this pandemic. So I would turn the question around. I would turn the question to whoever is listening to this. Recognize that it is your capability, the things that you do well, that you can bring to this challenge. Each of us has something that we do well. And if we put that together and work together with others, which is what we have to do in order to stop this pandemic, we're going to be able to do it. And it's because of that shared action, not anyone, and just like you can't protect yourself eventually from the disease. We also can't get everyone to work together without getting everyone to work together.
Yeah.
But the way to do that is by having everyone bring their talents, whether it's in, you know, science, whether it's in art, whether it's in communication ability, whether it's in organizing, whether it's in knowing how to, you know, reach out to people in order to get them involved. This is an all hands on deck effort. So everybody can ask themselves, what can I do to help my community, to help Alberta, to help Canada and the world get out of this horrendous situation that we've allowed to happen?
Thank you so much for your time today, Doctor.
Thank you.